electronically.
Oh, so you ain't done your test.
God is great, he's greatly to be praised. God is great in my soul. God is great, he's greatly to be praised. God is great in my soul.
God is great, he's greatly to be praised. God is great in my soul. God is great, he's greatly to be praised.
I know that God is great in my soul. God is great, he's greatly to be praised. God is great in my soul.
God is great, he's greatly to be praised.
I know that God is great in my soul.
God is great, he's greatly to be praised.
God is great in my soul.
God is great, he's greatly to be praised.
God is great
in my soul.
Hallelujah, praise Hallelujah. The Lord, saints. We're thanking and praising God to be back here on Wednesday night for our Bible class. Thank and praise God that you have joined us on this evening, amen, for our Wednesday night Bible class. We're just grateful that God is keep on doing great things for us. Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall be glad and rejoice in it. We're going to go before the Lord in prayer. Ask you to remember those. Amen. Hallelujah. And still sick and shut in. We're continuing to pray for Sister Mary Moden that we've heard of. Report that she's doing well, and we continue
Lord.
To keep her in prayer. With Sister Tootie, amen. We're asking you to remember Sister Thomas in prayer. All those that are sick and shut in, Deacon Whitby, amen. We're glad to hear his voice, amen. And all those that are sick and shut in, all those that are in bereavement, amen. We're asking God to let his loving arms be around them. At this time, we're going to go before the Lord in prayer. Lord Jesus, we come before you, thanking and praising you, Lord, for this day, for this very hour. We thank and praise you for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you for being God and God alone, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your keeping power. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your truth and for your mercy. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for being our God and Savior. Lord, we ask you to direct our path. Even on this afternoon, Lord Jesus, this evening, we ask you to direct your word. Send forth your word. Let it do what it set out to do. Bless your people. Let it take, hallelujah, root in our hearts and our minds. And let it be a light unto our path and comfort to our souls. Encourage and strengthen your people, my God. Help us, O Lord Jesus, to turn from our wicked ways and humble ourselves, Lord Jesus, my God, that you may heal this land. Amen. And that you may save your people. We ask you to bless each and every prayer request, my God, spoken and unspoken, in Jesus' name. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. Tonight, amen. I want to come before you tonight just to encourage you. Amen. I just want to I'm so grateful, and amen. I'm so full of all the praises that God I've seen on Facebook, and amen, and what God is doing in this day and time. This is the day that the Lord has made. Amen. And we shall be glad and rejoice in it. The Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, with Bishop Brooks, our presiding bishop, is doing a phenomenal job. And the missionaries are praying every Monday night. Amen. And along with that, ministers' wives are praying. They had a 24-hour prayer session Monday night. It's just amen. They're just doing a great job of keeping the saints informed and connected. Amen. Just God is doing a great thing. To God be the glory, for he is doing this. Amen. He is doing this. Amen. It tells me, it makes me to know that if he be lifted up, all men will be drawn unto him. And the faith of a mustard seed, God is moving mountains for the church. Amen. If the church just stay with one accord, amen, stay with their eyes lifted up to the hills. Amen. Stay on their knees praying. Stay in a repentant state. God can do great things with his people. Amen. God is doing great things with Apostolic Church of Jesus. He has kept us, amen, through our prayer. Amen. I just was so excited. Amen. I am excited about getting on, amen, every day at 7 o'clock. We're not on there long, but, amen, that 20 to 30 minute prayer, amen, every day has blessed me. And has kept me, amen, and has blessed many of those that have gotten on there, amen. But I just hope after all this is said and done, amen, after all this is done, amen, that God, that we won't forget what God is doing and has done We won't forget the power of God and what he's doing right now for us. Amen. I hope that once God we get to, amen, where God has taken us, that we won't forget, amen, what he's doing right now. I remember, amen, when I was filled with the Holy Ghost at the age of 17, and I had just got through, amen, and I began speaking in tongues, and I was just on fire running around the church and speaking in tongues, praising God. I just had a good old time. And I remember my assistant pastor at the time, who was later to be my pastor, Pacific Bishop Clifton Hoke, he said to me, don't forget this moment. Don't forget what God is doing for you right now. Don't forget the realness. Don't forget the connection that you had with God on tonight. And that's what I come to tell the church, in Apostolic Church of Jesus. Don't forget what God is doing right now in the land. Don't forget this connection that you have with him right now. And through your prayer and through your study and through this time that you've consecrated yourself into the Lord. Don't forget what that feels like. Don't forget how it feels to be in the moment. Don't forget how it feels to be in the presence of God. Don't turn away from this. Amen. Don't let this feeling go. Amen. This is where God wants us, in his face, seeking him that his will be done, seeking him that he can work wonders in our life. Amen. So don't forget this. When it's all said and done, don't forget, amen, what this feels like. Amen. God is still in control. We can no longer have church as usual. Amen. But we must serve God. We must serve God with the fullness of our heart. We're going to go to Isaiah 43. Just to want to put something in your ear. Isaiah 43. We keep hearing that God, we heard about God before this, but now we know him. Amen. Now we have a relationship. Now we're getting to know God. Amen. And it's so good. It's so good. Amen. Amen. So Isaiah 43:7. Going to start there. Going to do some jumping around. Amen. And along with that, we're going to end up in Revelation, but we're going to skip around a little bit. So Isaiah 43 says, even everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. I have formed him. Yea, I have made him. Ye are my witnesses, in verse 10, saith the Lord, my servant whom I have chosen. God, we didn't choose God. God chose you. Amen. So many people think they chose God. They chose this. They chose that. But God chose you. Amen. You're not in control like you would think. God called you. You answered. God chose you. He brought you out of darkness. Amen. He chose you to be his servant, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. I am the Lord, and beside me there is no Savior. I have declared, and I have saved. I have showed when there was no strange God among you. Therefore ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, that I am God. Yea, before the day was, I am he, and there is none that can deliver out of my hand. I will work, and who shall let it? God is in control. He is in control. Amen. No man has to give God permission to do anything. He is in control. He said, there is none that can deliver out of his hand. Remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Amen. It shall spring forth. God is doing a new thing in the land. Never have we experienced anything like this before. And from what I hear, it will never be the same after this. Things will never go back to like they were before. So this is a new season. God is doing a new thing. God is calling his people. God is calling his people to humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways. God is calling us to a higher praise. God is calling us to do greater things. Amen. We got comfortable. We got too relaxed. We can start conforming to the things of this world. We want to be like the world. But God wants us to come out of darkness. God wants us to be holy, sanctified, separated from sin. Not of this world. We have to be in this world, but we're not of this world. So God is doing a new thing in our life. He's showing us, hallelujah, who he is and the power that he has. And he's calling us to be greater. He's calling us to be better. He's calling us to be more powerful. He's calling for us to show forth his praises in the land. Amen. To show forth his light in this world. He wants us to be, hallelujah, the church that he's called us to be. Holy, holy, clean, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, powerful. He's calling us to be those things for his glory, for his glory. Hallelujah. And Isaiah 44, it says, thus said the Lord, the King of Israel, 44:6, his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first, I am the last, and beside me there is no God. He's the first and the last. This is God. In Isaiah 44 said, I am the first and I am the last, and beside me there is no God. Now we've seen that somewhere else in the Bible. Hallelujah. We've seen that somewhere else where God is calling himself the first and the last. But in Revelations 1:18, amen, or 1:11, let's go to 1:11 first. It says, Revelations 1:11, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. But thou seest, write a book and send it unto the seven churches. Amen. I am the first. I am the last. And it says in 17, fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and death. So God said he was the first and the last in Isaiah 44:6. And then he said it in Revelations. Now in Revelation, we know that Jesus is speaking. Amen. And we know that there can't be two firsts, and there can't be two lasts. There's only one first, and there's only one last. Amen? You in first place, or you can be in last place, but you can't be two people in first place. Amen? It don't work like that. It's one in first. There's one last. And God said he's the first, and he's the last. And God said it in Isaiah, and then he came back and said it in Revelations in 1:11 and 1:17 and 1:18. So we're talking about Jesus. Jesus is God. He's the only true and living God. And that's who we serve. That's the salvation. That's our doctrine. We stand on that Jesus is God. He is holy. He is the first. He is the last. There's no Savior beside him. There's no God after him or before him. Hallelujah. But he's doing a new thing in the land. That world is calling it unprecedented. The world is calling it, and they're fearful. They don't know what to do. I get more information through the preachers, through the word, through prayer than I do on the evening news. There's more information about what's going on today in the Bible that was written over 2,000 years ago than I can get on the evening news. They don't know what's going on. They can't tell me. They can't explain it. But God is in control, and he's telling us. He's called this. He's told us what's to come. God is saying he's in control, and he's talking to his church, and he wants his church to get it together. He wants his church to humble themselves and pray. He wants his church to seek his face so he, amen, can be glorified on earth. But we're going into Revelation, this is the second chapter. We're talking now about the seven churches, and we know the seven means complete. Amen. We know the number seven is complete. We're going to get into this. I hope I can, amen, finish it tonight. Amen. I didn't know it was going to take so much, amen, in reading the seven churches. I thought I was going to go through it and be able to be done. But it's so much in talking about just the first church, amen, in the Bible. This letter, John, we know John, amen, is the writer of the book of Revelation. God revealed, God gave John while he was on the Isle of Patmos, amen, the revelation. And we know that the Isle of Patmos was a deserted island, amen. It was a fruitless, rocky island. It was uninhabitable, amen. And we know this was right off the shore of Minor Asia, or modern Turkey as we know it today. But God gave John a revelation of what was to come. Amen. It was happening back then, and it was going to happen in the future. These are the seven conditions of the church, seven eras of the church. Amen. It's still speaking to the church today, amen, of how God is dealing with his people and how his people are so, we are so fickle. Amen. We are saved today, and the next day we're cold one day, we're hot the next. But we got to stay on fire. We got to stay ready for God. Amen. So let's get into our reading of Revelations, starting at the second chapter and the first verse. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, write these things, saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Now we know that the seven stars represent the angels, represent the messenger. Amen. We know the seven candlesticks, amen, represent the churches. Amen. We know that candlesticks represent light. We know that the candle represent light. And we are, the candlestick holds the light. We're just the candlestick. We have the light. Jesus is the light. But we are the candlestick holding up the light. God is wanting to bring his light, his glory back into the church. God wants his glory to be in the church. So we are the seven, the church is represented by the seven candlesticks. And the stars is represented by the angel. Amen. Amen. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the light. In the second verse, he says, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them that are evil. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them to be liars. Amen. So God is speaking to his church. God is omnipresent. God knows everything. God knows your heart. He knows the very hairs on your head. But what caught my eye was that he said he know and had found them to be liars. You have examined the preachers. You examine. We have become pit bulls. A former pastor made us pit bulls when it comes to the word of God. Amen. You have to back it up with the word of God. And in 1 John, it says in 1 John 4, in 1 John 4 and 1, amen, 1 John 4 and 1, amen, in the first verse, 1 John 4 and 1, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirit, whether they are God, because many false preachers or prophets have gone out into the world. How do you try the preacher? How do you know that the preacher is telling the truth or not? You got to be led by the Holy Ghost, and you got to know the word. Amen. You don't know who's false or right unless you have a word. Because some preachers can preach you up under the table. Some false prophets can teach and preach us under the table if you don't know what you're talking about, if you don't know what they're talking about. They sound real good. They can shake the mic. They can groan and they can moan, amen, and they can put words together, and they got all kind of letters after their name. But if they're not filled with the Holy Ghost, they cannot lead God's people. They cannot teach God's people. If you don't have the Spirit of God, how can you teach? Amen. How can you teach? The Bible says, amen, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. And how can they teach unless they're sent by God? How can they teach you unless they've been sent by God? How can you sit up under somebody that ain't been sent by God? Because they look good? That's the problem with Israel. They picked the king because he was head and shoulders above the rest. God did not tell us to walk by sight. But he said, be led by the Spirit. Be led by the Spirit. If you're led by the Spirit, then you don't have to worry about anything. You don't have to worry about strain. You don't have to worry about getting lost. If you allow God to lead and guide you in the way of truth, that's what the Holy Ghost is for. To lead and guide you into all truth. In the third verse, it says, and has borne and has patience, and for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted. Amen. The saints are faithful coming through sick, amen, through thick and thin, amen. We have to change the rules because some saints will show up sick sometimes, tired, amen. But in this next phase, amen, if you're sick, stay home, amen. We don't want you to come and be sick, and you might, amen, give somebody else something. Amen. We don't know. In this day and time, we have to be careful. Amen. But the saints of God will come even when they're sick. They will come. They will press their way. And in verse 4, it says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. This is where I wanted to get tonight. Thou hast left thy first love. We have to put God back in his rightful place. And his rightful place is to be the head of our lives. He has to be first in everything we do. He has to be first in everywhere we go. We have to put God first back in his rightful place. When we put God first, we put him back where he belongs, exalted and lifted up. Things will come together like they should. When you don't do that, anything can happen. It doesn't work without God being first. Nothing you will do will work without God being first. Amen. In Matthew 22 and 37. Matthew 22 and 37. Let's go there. Matthew 22, start at 37th verse. And it says, Jesus said unto them, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And this is the first and great commandment. This is the first and great commandment. Deuteronomy 6 and 4 said, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And we shall love the Lord our God with all our what? Mind, body, and soul. And it said this right here in Matthew, it said it again. This is the first commandment. This is where God should be. This is how we should be loving God. This is what we should be doing. Loving God with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our mind, with everything within us. Everything within us, praise his holy name. With everything in us, hallelujah, love God with it. Hallelujah. Give God everything. We owe him everything. It's 1 John, and we read 1 John 4:16. 1 John 4:16. Let's go there right quick. 1 John 4:16. It says, and we have known and believed the love that God hath toward us. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. And herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There's no fear in love. Hallelujah. There is no fear in love. There's no fear in Jesus. If we're abiding in him and he in us, there should be no fear. God has not given us the spirit of fear. Through all of these things that's happening in the world, we should not have the spirit of fear. Even though what we see with our eyes is very scary, but what we know in our soul and our spirit that God said he'll never leave us nor forsake us. So if God is with us, there's no reason to fear. There's no reason to doubt. Amen. Whether he blesses over here or on the other side, God is with us and God is fighting for us. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. If we hold on to God's unchanging hand, if we keep God's commandment, if we fear him, and keep his word, amen, we have no reason to doubt that God is going to bring us out. We have no reason to fear that God is not going to be with us. We have no reason to be afraid, because God is with us. The Lord is our life and our salvation. Whom shall we fear? The Lord is the strength of our life. Whom shall we be afraid? There's no reason to fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear. God is with us. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the work, and do the first works. What's the first work? To love thy God with all thy heart, with all thy mind, and with all thy soul. Or else I will come unto thee quickly, and remove thy candlestick out of this place, except thou repent. Amen. Repent. But this thou hatest the deeds of Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. God is calling for us to repent and get back to the place where we once were, in love with Jesus, in love with God, in his presence, in, hallelujah, his word. We have to get back to that place where we were in love with Jesus. You know how you were. You were on fire for the Lord. Amen. You couldn't dance enough. You couldn't talk. You couldn't tell people enough about Jesus. You were excited, on fire for the Lord, telling them how much you were in love with this man called Jesus. And we got to get back to that place where we're talking and walking about Jesus. They said, when you see me coming, I got Jesus on my mind. Amen. We got to get back to that place. When you see me coming, I got Jesus on my mind. I got Jesus in my heart. I got Jesus in my soul. I got Jesus when I wake up in the morning. I got Jesus when I lay down at night. I got to keep Jesus forefront in my life. Jesus got to become that important to me again. God has to take his place back in my life. Allow God to be God. Allow God to be first. Allow God to be God. Allow God to lead you. Hallelujah. And amen. When I used to be out in the world, I used to social. They always say, let the man lead. I had a hard time with that. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Because I wanted to lead. Amen. I felt like I was the best dancer. I felt like I knew the moves. I know which way to go. Hallelujah. But you got to, hallelujah, let God lead you. Let God lead you. Let God have his way. God knows, hallelujah, the way of the dance. God knows the way of the journey. God knows what he's doing. He's in control. Amen. We have to wake up out of stupor. We got to shake this life off. We got to shake this worldly thinking off. Get back to the basis. Get back to God. Get back to life. Get back to living holy. Get back to living right. Get back to living excited about Jesus. Get back. The churches need to get back to serving God in these churches. We're so caught up in names and what church and how big and who's preaching. We got to get back to Jesus. We got to get back to God. We got to get back to worship. I was going to church when I was 17 years old, to my little old church on Hamilton in Holland Park. It didn't matter. The preacher was the same preacher. I don't remember a whole lot of guest speakers coming in, but I was excited about being in the house of the Lord. That's what we got to get back to, just being in God's presence. No matter who preaching or teaching, as long as the word is going forth, let God, hallelujah, have his way. Amen. Stop wanting to be seen. It's time out to all those dressing up and wanting to go somewhere. We got to just sit and listen and hear what thus saith the Lord. Get on fire for what God is saying, not who you're going to meet that night. Get on fire to what God is leading you and telling you. Hallelujah. We got to come with a fire and a praise. That scripture, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise, should have a new meaning in your life. Hallelujah. It should have a new meaning. Saints of God, amen. That's my time. But I hope and I pray that you understand we got to repent and get back to our first love. We have gotten away from our first love. Our first love is Jesus. Loving God with our whole mind, soul, and body. We got to get back to that place, to loving Jesus. Saints of God, hallelujah. If there's anything I said tonight, we got to love Jesus. We got to love him first. God laid down his life for us. Amen. He laid down his life for the church. Amen. For us. Amen. To put him first. Put God first, and God will do the rest. God bless you. Amen. We hope you're praying for us. Amen. We're asking God to bless us. We know that God is in control. There's no reason to fear. There's no reason to doubt that God is going to bring us out, and he's going to bring us through. Amen. We will be praying tomorrow night again. Amen. We pray every night at 7 o'clock. Amen. And the prayer has been awesome. God has blessed our prayer. God has blessed those that's in our prayer. There's a lot of sickness, but God has delivered them all. And we're giving God praise and all glory and honor for all he has done for us. Amen. We're still praying for the bishops. We're still praying for the pastors. in the organization. We're thankful and praise God for the praise reports that we heard about Bishop Grayson and Pastor Donnie Falk. Amen. We're just thanking, praising God for that. We're still praying for Mother Falk. Amen. And all the bishops, especially our bishop, our presiding bishop, who's doing a wonderful job. We're just asking God to bless. Amen. Bless all the churches that we be together on one accord, that God can bless us and keep us and take us to the next level. Amen. God bless you. And we hope that you're praying for us. In Jesus' name, and good night.
But when Adam bit of the tree, heaven doors closed, and we had no more access to God.